Good morning.
Good morning.
So good to see you all here today. It's so good to be here. John and I are going to get our schedule worked out so that, you know, we're alternating back and forth. So we just have been in a kind of a disoriented sphere. But it, you know what? It's coming together and we're both feeling more grounded. So that's good news. I want to be sure that I announce today that on December 2nd, there's something going on in Waterville. It's like Light Up Waterville. And it's starting at the steps of Zion. So we're hoping people will come and sing Christmas carols as people gather, you know? So go ahead and I hope you'll come. It starts at 5:30. I imagine parking will be interesting. I don't know, maybe you all are better informed about this. I mean, Rick is going now. So please mark your calendars because we get to sing Christmas carols, which is my favorite. This is my favorite time of year. Also know that there are some Christmas quilts. I learned from Sandy that they can't send, I didn't know this, you can't send quilts to Lutheran World Relief that have any kind of orientation to a religion. Or what? Or Christmas. So those are on sale. There's two different sizes. They're on sale in the fellowship hall. So if you'd like to pick one of those out, and I've got one from a grandson already that I have picked out. Yeah. And then you write, if you decide to do that, you write a check to St. Paul's Lutheran Church, and in the memo, write in Quilting Fund. Yeah? Okay. Are there any other announcements that need to be? Yes, Laura.
We have a pie auction today. Does anybody have a pie auction? The Clyde F. Stadium Scholarship Fund. So if you want a pie to take home for all those Thanksgiving gatherings, we'll have everyone kind of get started eating and then take a good look at the pies on the table with the Thanksgiving tablecloth.
That's good news. I mean, not as good as Jesus was raised from the dead, but pies auctioning. What could go wrong with pies, right? Yes. Oh, hi. Thing to do at home. I want to always remind folks that Luther wrote the Small Catechism not for pastors to teach, but for parents to teach. And it gives us, it gives us a chance to have some structure and practice with Lord's Prayer, with the Creed, with the 10 words from God. So this is a perfect time for families to follow up at home. And you know, families have different expressions, right? Might be something that grandma and grandpa want to do, aunts and uncles, friends who are like families. So see what opportunity you have to share in that. Thank you for those announcements too, Stacey. Are there any other announcements? Okay, if not, then it's our good pleasure to have the kids come forward. So today we're going to be reading from Matthew's, the Gospel of Matthew. And there are how many Gospels are there? Four. Who can name them? No, the names of the Gospel stories. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, right? So today's story is from Matthew. And it's about how we can... wait for Jesus to return, because that's part of the promise, is that Jesus is going to come back and wreak, and just the whole cosmos, it's going to be ginormous, made new, and that God's love will be fulfilled. It blows my mind. I don't know how to, you know what I'm saying? It's huge. It's about God. So today, Matthew is writing a story about How do we respond to God's love? Is everybody okay? How do we respond to God's love while we wait for this? Yes, do you have some ideas? We pray. Boom. How about anybody else? What else can we do? Yes. That's okay. Think about it. Yes. What else can we do? Be helpful. Who are some people we could be helpful to? God, yes. How about our neighbors? Or our friends at school? Or our family? We could be helpful. And we're going to be helpful to a family that needs help at Christmas, right? So we can do that. Yes.
I'll be nice with my sister.
You are nice to your sister. I'm very happy to hear that. Yes, I think that's a very important thing. Now, the other thing I want to say before we move on is this. God has given all of you gifts, and I'm just learning about them. Some of you are leaders. Some of you are wonderful at visiting. Some of you, it seems to me, are good listeners. That is very important in the world right now. And so I'm just enjoying this time of learning what your gifts are, okay? But when God gives us a gift, gives it away, then it means we need to, or we get to, just use that gift in the world, okay?
Okay.
Thank you. So let's pray, all right? God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for... I thank you for these children. I know the whole congregation does. Thank you for their parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles and everyone who's involved in their faith journey. Thank you for the promise that Jesus loves us and will come back for us. And thank you also for all those who are suffering this day. Thank you for the opportunity, not for their suffering, but thank you for the opportunity to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, bring water to those who are thirsty, and to visit those in prison. All these things we pray in your most holy and precious and sweet name of Jesus. Amen. Thanks for coming up, y'all.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Oh.
Okay, my little... Oh. You know, I'm thinking that these kids might be able to lead Grace on Thanksgiving gatherings with that. At this time, I ask the congregation to stand if you are able. And we will, those kids, what a blessing. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved in the waters of our baptism. Amen. Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, we are forgiven. By Jesus, we are welcome. In Jesus, we are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen. Amen.
Come, ye thankful people, come, raise the song of harvest home. All the safely gathered in, ere the winter storms begin. God, our Maker, doth provide for our wants to be supplied. Come to God's own temple, come, raise the song of harvest home. All the world is God's own field, fruit unto his praises yield. Wheat and tares together sown, first of all sorrow grown. First the blade and then the ear, then the foghorn doth appear. Lord of harvest, grant that we hold some grain and pure may be. For the Lord our God shall come and shall take his harvest home. His field will in that day all offenses purge away. Give his angels charge at last in the fire the tares to cast. But the fruitful ears to store in his garner
from sin.
Therefore, ever purify
in thy garner to abide. Come with all mine angels, come, raise the glorious harvest home.
You may be seated.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And
and also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Worthy is Christ, the Lamb who was power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and blessing and glory are his. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. Sing with all the people of God. Join in the hymn of all creation.
Be with you. Let us pray. Loving Lord, you have searched your people for evidence of goodness. The way fruit is sought in a vineyard. Send your righteous judge and find goodness in your faithful children. Amen.
Our first reading is from Psalm 90. We will read the psalm responsively. Lord, you have been our refuge from one generation to another.
Before the mountains were brought forth, or the land and the earth were born, from age to age, you are God.
You turn us back to the dust and say, turn back, O children of earth.
For a thousand years in your sight are like yesterday, when it is past, and like a watch in the night.
You sweep them away like a dream. They fade away suddenly, like the grass.
In the morning it is green and flourishes. In the evening it is dried up and withered.
For we are consumed by your anger. We are afraid because of your wrath.
Our iniquities have set before you, and our secret sins in the light of your countenance.
When you are angry, all our days are gone. We bring our years to an end like a sigh.
The span of our life is 70 years, perhaps in strength even 80.
sorrow, for they pass away quickly, and we are gone.
Who regards the power of your wrath? Who rightly fears your indignation?
So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, and saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow, and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all these who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to God.
That's some great reading, Wayne. Thank you. Please pray with me before the word is proclaimed. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be holy and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our crucified and risen Redeemer. Amen. Okay, so if you don't mind pulling up Psalm 90 one more time. It's one of my favorite ones. I have my funeral planned. We have to do that when we go to seminary, because how can we ask other people to deal with death and dying if we aren't dealing with our own mortality? Then came flash drives. This is when I had like these floppy things, and then it went to the hard thing, and then, I mean, so now I have a flash drive. And the great thing about this is I change things all the time. So Psalm 90 is one of those things that I put on, I take off, I rethink, but so it's back on there. What I want to do is really take a look at, I forgot my cards. This psalm really speaks to the story in Matthew today. And I just want to make sure we're on the same page when it comes to reading this particular gospel. It's first century Judaism. Nero is emperor, and he was brutal. And the Jews were persecuted, and he kept sending folks in to steal, you know, things from the temple. It's bad. And then the temple was destroyed for the last time. And so what happened then is the Jewish community would assemble. The word for this in Greek is synagoge. So it's the assembly. And I would like to just, that's a whole nother sermon, but sit on that a little bit. Think about that, pray about that, because it's not this building, y'all. It's where we gather, but we can assemble anywhere. So, and more about that later. Now, the other thing about this is, though there were some written sayings of Jesus, there was Mark's gospel by the time Matthew was reading, this comes mostly from an oral tradition, which, you know, think about this. I can't remember anything. I'm a visual learner, so this was something that the early church, even millennia before that, you know, we didn't have social media, we didn't have our phones to go, right? It had to be told. So when Paul writes in Romans, blessed are the feet of those who bring good news. There were runners, you know, that were given a message orally, A-U, right? And then had to tell it orally. So we got to kind of get into that, you know what I mean? So imagine being a runner and someone who's giving oral instruction under the emperor Nero. This is why I almost every Sunday thank God that we live in a place where we can gather in safety. Now, I know there are other places, and this is under watch. We think about a lot of other gatherings, a lot of other assemblies that haven't been safe. So the author of Matthew is obviously Jewish, and he is living in relationship with the synagogue of the day. And what he believes is that Jesus is Messiah. Jesus is the Christ. So there is this gathering of Jews, primarily, we find out about Gentiles later, but of Jews who believe Jesus is Messiah. They're called the Messianic community. And that community believed that Jesus was the fulfillment of God's promises. That's kind of what I believe. I think that's what Luther believed. How about y'all? So part of this promise that God gives us is Jesus has gone to be with God in the future. So I wanted to we had to take summer Greek before we start seminary. I don't know how it is now, but okay. But I had this brilliant teacher, and he talked about how there's a tribe in Africa, and this is what they do. They step backwards into the future. Okay, our Western minds think we're walking towards the future. We don't know what's in the future. I don't know what tomorrow will bring. We step backward, trusting. Think of the trust that takes. So we step backwards into this. And part of what Matthew's community believed was this: the one thing we can trust, the ultimate thing we can trust, is that God is bringing the future to us. So with every step backwards, we are stepping into God's reigning. Because it's not this linear thing, it's just not us moving towards the future, God's future for us. God is bringing it to us all the time, every day, with every breath, in these waters of baptism. So now we have this community that is believing Jesus is Messiah. They're trying to spread this good news and practice this good news. And the there are still authorities in the synagogue, you know, Pharisees and scribes and, you know, Sadducees. And they are still, they're still waiting for Messiah. They don't believe Jesus is Messiah, right? So they have this strict order of rules that you have to follow in order to be included in the assembly. And Matthew's community is trying to say, Jesus is Messiah. Jesus is Messiah. Jesus is Messiah. Now, let's see, Matthew and his community are also still subject to the discipline by the synagogue authorities. So they're subject to that discipline, and Nero is on the loose. So I'm going to try to bring this part in. The author of Matthew's gospel is making a point that Jesus is Messiah. They are the messianic community. Jesus is the fulfillment of Hebrew scripture. We are grafted into that tree, y'all, of God's promise to deliver. I'm going to say the whole cosmos. They're waiting for Jesus to usher in God's final and complete reigning, God's shalom. We're still waiting, aren't we? So today's parable, and you know, there's three parables in a row here. So there's the one about keep your lamps trimmed and burning, the bridesmaids, right? Now there's this one. So let's take a look at this. One of the things I discovered, God's word is a living word, okay? That is just happens to me every day. So in my study for today, I learned something new. And it's this, that this word in Greek, where the NRSV is not probably the best translation. The word is didomai, and it means to give up, to hand over. So these talents that the master is handing over, he's giving. That is grace, y'all. He's giving them to them. He's hands off. He's giving gifts of great value. You know, I'm not even going to go into the, like, the talents of the denarii, because that's math in public. I can tell you that it's like gobs of money back then, okay? And so with this idea in mind, part of what happened was this last person in the parable is afraid. So I want you to just, if you don't mind, scroll down. I'm pulling this out on him at the last minute. Okay. Is afraid. He's like saying, what's that? Yeah, we're still going to the psalm. I'm sorry. Okay. So he's saying it's about the fear of the Lord. And we're mortal. We're like the grass, y'all. We're green in the morning, and we are dried up in the evening. So what do we do with that? So this poor slave or servant, let's just say the fourth dude in the gospel, in the parable, out of fear, the gift that was given to him, he was afraid. And that fear was his undoing. The other three accepted the gift. They were living in relationship, as I understand it theologically. This is me reading into the text. And they were able to use the giving of the master to expand and explode. This poor last person was afraid. Now I have, in my way of talking about theology, I have a system. I think I maybe have been mentioning that, you know, I was raised with this theology of I'm a sinner and God sent Jesus to cure my sin. And that's how our system of talking, so theology is how do we talk about God? Now I'm going to say, and I've checked this out with my systematic professor, Don Luck, okay, we've sat down, I'm not going to just do it myself, okay? I said, Don, now I start my God talk with God's love. It begins with God's love. So what does that mean? What does that look like in the world? What does this gift of love and grace and mercy, what do I do with that? Well, here are some examples. You have all been given gifts. I'm going to tell y'all, one of your gifts are these kids. And we're going to get them busy here and now. Now, I don't think about them in the future. They're the church of right now. And I thank God for that gift. Let's nurture that and care for it. But how do we wait for this Lord's coming? For our master to return. Does it occur to you day to day? My first class with Mark Allen Powell, who taught New Testament, he said, what if Jesus comes today? And it hadn't occurred to any of us. So then I graduated from seminary and I pray, Lord, if you want to come before I have to pay off the seminary debt, that'd be fantastic. And then after I paid it off, I said, okay, I'm just going to wait and, you know, keep going. Luther is known to have said in his table talks, what would you do if you knew Jesus was coming tomorrow? Think about that. If you knew Jesus was coming tomorrow, what would you do? Luther said, I'd plant a tree. Because he was going to trust in the life-giving love of God. So we were talking this morning, Tom and David and I, this is expressed in everything we do. It is expressed in when we go to the grocery store, do we take our cart back or do we kick it out? Tom had this thing where there was a person who saw him unloading groceries and she came and said, let me take your cart back for you. That, okay, I'm just saying, that is fruitful service right there. And all of you, in everything you do is an opportunity to share the light and love of God. So, like I said, I'm always praying during school year for teachers and bus drivers because they have a hard job, y'all. And then I pray for those people who are in medicine, first responders, all of those. Parents, I'm going to say that's the hardest job in the world. I thought, Lord, you made a mistake when you called me to be a mama. There were many, many times. So, but we keep on, don't we? There's this faithful, God gives us this gift of faith. Okay, so it happens everywhere. Now, last story, and then I'll conclude. So part of our training, seminary training, is we have to do something called clinical pastoral education. Janine, she's going through that right now. And I did my first 400 hours down in Tennessee. I stayed with my mom and dad, and I was in Knoxville, University of Tennessee, Knoxville. Go Vols. So we had three shifts. Lots of chaplains, and we would then split shifts, okay? So we'd do the first shift, and then at some point we would do the middle shift, and then at some point the last shift. So on this particular night, I'm in that last shift. It's the middle of the night. You all know now that I am geographically and spatially challenged. So what I would do in every single place is I go up to the top floor, and I did this every hour. And I would do rounds, then I'd take the steps down, do rounds on the next floor, take the steps down, see what I'm saying? So I got onto the floor, which was the pediatric intensive care unit. Some of you have been there. And I hear out of the hall, to come out of the elevator, I hear this soulful voice singing. Precious Lord, take my hand. Sing with me. Lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night. And da 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 da. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me home. I fell to my knees in the hallway. I was all by myself. And I wept from the beauty of it. And it soothed my soul, like I don't even know how to tell you. I walk on the unit, and there is a grandma who is rocking her granddaughter, who has had a number of, you know, problems with her disease. And she was dying. She was anticipating, you know, we always anticipate through death that that's where we're going. But this woman, when I visited with her, she said, the Lord's coming for her, and I'm going to sing her into his arms. Think of that witness. This day we give thanks that God has given us gifts. It begins with love, and it moves to grace and mercy, and it fills us up so we are ready to make sure our one little light lights another candle, so that in the darkness, God's glory starts to shine. I'm so thankful for you, and I'm thankful for these promises of God, I just want to say thank you. I can't say it enough. I love you. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Immortal, invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. Most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days, Almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Unresting, unhasting, and silent as night, not wanting nor wasting thy ruling might. Like justice, like tempest, like clouds which are fountains, uplifted and love. To all that thee givest to
turn our hearts to God, our breath and life, as we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Gracious God, You give talents and gifts to all your people, and you equip the church to serve. Turn us from fear and self-serving ways, that we use our talents to glorify you and encourage our neighbor. Hear us, O God. You have been our dwelling place from one generation to another. Sustain the life of the planet. Protect farmlands and harvests. Direct all people in wise stewardship of all the earth's resources. Hear us, O God. You call us to honesty and integrity. Instill these values in the hearts of all nations and their leaders. Free any who are oppressed. Expose all corruption. And bring redemption to victims of injustice. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You teach us to count our days, that we may gain a wise heart. Where there is sickness or sorrow, bring healing. And where there is loneliness, reveal your love in community. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for the faith formation ministries of our church. Give to all children, youth, and adults who study your word the breastplate of faith and love. Shape us by your love, and show us how to encourage one another. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Gracious God, you are faithful in all generations. For the promise of life and rest, and for the witness of those who have died in faith, we praise your goodness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We offer our spoken prayers and those held in our hearts, trusting in your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Now we can, if you feel comfortable, let's share that peace with a hug, a handshake, a elbow bump, whichever you want, or a kiss. A smooch is perfect. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. It's out there, man. Peace be with you. Change me. You heard the good news. Jesus is raised from the dead. This is on.
Receiving of the offering, yes.
Wagner, Douglas E. Wagner. I'm used to William. Okay, thank you. That was beautiful.
So we stand. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures hear me low. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Let us pray. God of all goodness, generations have turned to you, gathered around your table, and shared your abundant blessings. Number us among them that, as we gather these gifts from your abundance and give thanks for your rich blessings, we may feast upon your very self and care for all that you have made through Jesus Christ, our sovereign and servant. Amen. I see the first note. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks, thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lamb, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name. Hosanna in the highest.
On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He blessed it. He broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, given for you. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink from this cup, do so, remembering me." Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus invites you to this table. It's your gift. Come as you are. I would like to just say one thing. We're trying something new here. We're trying something old. So we're going to be singing during communion. We're going to start with the Agnus Dei, the Lamb of God, and then you'll find that there's the next hymn after that. Thank you.
Thank you.
many the gifts, many the graves, but in the Lord of all, one bread a day. Bless which we bless.
this, y'all. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in this simple meal, you have set a banquet. Sustain us on the journey. Strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children. And give us glad and generous hearts as we meet you on the way. Amen. I want to thank Rick and Peter because this thing back here is fantastic, okay? I love it. May the God of all creation, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved, who strengthens us for service, give you reason to rejoice and be glad. The blessing of God, Sovereign, Savior, and Spirit, be with you today and always. Amen.
Let's stand.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you.